Hi, Jenny.
Hey, how are you?
I'm
Here
good. How about you?
I am. Oh, I love your background picture.
That's the first fire engine I ever rode when I was 3 years old.
No kidding. And that was in New Jersey.
Yes. Cedarville, New
Oh,
Jersey.
I love it. How'd you get a picture of it?
I used to take pictures of fire engines, and a matter of fact, if you come to my house, I have over 12,000 of them, photos and slides. And so, on one of my trips back home, I got a hold of one of the guys that I knew, and he maneuvered things around for me. So that's how I got it. And at the time,
Wow.
it was being replaced. This was just going out of service, and it was being replaced by a brand new rig. And they talked to me about buying it,
Oh,
because it
did
was my,
they?
$1,500. It could have been mine. And it's like,
Oh,
wow, yeah. You know what? If I had been living in the area, I would have probably bought it. But when you look
yeah.
at the fact that I had to get that out to Colorado, and that meant either driving it or putting it on a flatbed, and then once I got it here, it's like, where am I going to put it?
Yeah, your wife would love it in the front yard, right?
It wouldn't fit in the driveway.
It's sort of like it used to be a guy and his dog, that the wife was competing against, but now, okay, a fire engine, nope, I've never heard
I'll
that
tell
before.
you, guys that own antique fire engines wind up putting a lot of time and a lot of money into it. There's
Yeah.
a gentleman up in Estes Park named Doug Klink, and he has the Reliance Fire Museum, and he's also a volunteer firefighter with Estes Valley.
Huh.
I had a video business card done back in August, and Doug allowed me and the guy who did the video and my nephew to come up there, and we spent 5 hours up there. Thaddeus is the guy who shot it, of Crow Hill
Wow.
Digital, and Thaddeus did a great job, but we were there for 5 hours,
Oh
moving
my
cameras
goodness.
around. Yeah, and he put it together in a video, and it's up on my website.
Oh, is it really?
Yeah.
Oh, well, what's the website?
Impactus, Impactus Leadership, Impactus Leadership.
Okay. So that is also your company name, Impactus Leadership.
My company name is Impactus, Cultivating Today's Leaders.
Oh, okay. Oh, I
Yeah.
didn't realize it was the full thing. So you shortened it so that it would be easier for people to get onto your website.
Yeah.
Yeah,
Yeah.
that's great. Cool. Wow. My brother, I've got a brother who's in firefighting, volunteer,
Okay.
back south of Buffalo in a
Oh.
town called Allegheny, New York.
Allegheny.
Yes, and he has done it all his life. He used to have the what is it, like a CB that you have so that it's rotating and when calls come in, and he knew all the slang and all that stuff, but he did it starting at a young age also. And he's gotten one of his sons into doing
Okay.
firefighting volunteer as well. But he just absolutely loved it. I think that when your heart's into it, you
Yeah.
just can't let it go. So it's playing all night long. I'm sure his wife didn't appreciate that because he's not on call now at midnight and 3 in the morning, but he knows the information when it comes in.
I used to have that, a scanner.
Yeah, that's what it is. Yeah. It helped us because there was this one time my dad, who was a pilot, was flying out of Elmira and he didn't quite feel good. He had gotten cleared for takeoff and all, and he was going to take off. But since he didn't feel good, he turned around and went back. And Elmira and Allegheny weren't all that far. So he had gone in the bathroom and collapsed. And somehow my brother picked up on it and was able to communicate, get my mother over to there and to coordinate everything because he knew all the codes and everything and knew what to say, how to say it.
Yeah, well, Elmira was the home of two fire engine manufacturers for years. The first one was American LaFrance. They'd been around since the 1800s. And then the other one was Ward LaFrance. And so, yeah, American LaFrance was a staple in the American fire apparatus industry for years and years.
Fascinating. And who handles it now? Is it bought out or?
I think the American LaFrance name is still out there. You know, a number of these companies have changed hands over the years.
Yes.
You know, there's some big ones here, you know, in the country. Pierce is in Appleton, Wisconsin. Seagrave, I think they're still up in Wisconsin. There's KME out of Pennsylvania. There's some in South Dakota, one in South Dakota. Let's see, one up in Minnesota. There was one right here in Loveland. SVI trucks, but a couple of years ago, they were not able to work things out with the city and expansion. And so they moved up to Fort Collins, and they have a large facility up there. And they initially started out building solely rescue trucks, and now, you know, it's expanded into building actual pumpers as well. And, you know, it's not uncommon to find their rigs all over the country. Matter of fact, my younger brother lives in Elkins, West Virginia, and there's a truck sitting in the firehouse in Elkins from SVI when they were here in Loveland.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Now, why did they change color from red to this greenish color? I mean, I love red. I mean, that's the color that you think of for a fire truck.
Well, there were studies that came out in the early 70s, you know, and I can't remember where they originated from. But it had to do with highway visibility, and they were also looking at the color of, you know, Department of Transportation trucks from the various states, you know, and then public works from the cities. And, you know, and frankly, it was some genius that says, oh, hey, you know, you need to have lime green. and so there, you know, a number of departments switched over. I was a firefighter in the Air Force at the time, and so the Air Force made the decision to do it. And then to save money, you know, they put all of us around the trucks with sanders and sandpaper and sanding off the paint, so it could go to, you know, down to the motor pool and get repainted. It's like, oh, this is a real smart move.
No. Yeah. So the paint was halfway off as you're rushing to these fires to put them out. So the truck doesn't look completely red. It looks down to the gray.
It was like another genius move. But you know, growing up in New Jersey, even before that lime green, you know, thing took effect, you know, popularity, there was a lot of departments back there that had rigs that are green, blue, blue and white, dark yellow. Yeah, I mean, a lot of really beautiful colors, even going on up into, you know, the New York area where your brother and nephew, you know, our firefighters at. There was white rigs as well. You know, Denver has had white rigs, you know, I think even at the inception of when motorized apparatus came around.
Well, that doesn't help with the snow. When there's snow, there's no contrast there.
No.
Oh, well, I guess they're trying out the palette, right?
Yeah.
Well, somebody's making money. You know, a lot of times all these things end up boiling down to where is somebody making the money?
Absolutely. You know?
Our tax dollars going?
Yeah. And the price of these rigs has just climbed so high over the years that it is incredible. It's unbelievable. The trucks have gotten much bigger, but a lot of the price increases have been related to emissions controls, and then that gets tacked on, and the manufacturers add on the price. And then there's a lot of safety features, you know, as well. Like when I first came in, 76 is when I officially became a firefighter, started hanging out at the firehouse at 14 after my dad died. But when I first came on the job, for a good number of years, we rode on the back step, of the fire engine, then there was, for the departments that I was with, in the military, there was a gradual transition. And now the aircraft rescue firefighting trucks are trucks. Yeah, you were always seated inside in the ones that we had, but it was the structural pumpers, where we were riding in the back step. And so I think, stretch here, I think it was about 1980. Yeah, approximately 1980. I was stationed at a base down in North Carolina when we got our first truck that, modern truck, I should say, that, you rode inside the cab. We had an older one that was manufactured by that Ward LaFrance that I was telling you about earlier. They had manufactured this special fire, I say special, but, really for the time in America, it definitely was special and ahead of its time. It was really a box-shaped truck, kind of ugly looking thing, and the crew rode inside, and then even the pump panel had a insulated covered door to drop down over it, and there was a heater in there. And the truck was initially designed to be assigned to bases in areas that were subject to freezing, and so we rarely ever used that rig. If we were overstaffed, we would put firefighters on it. But America for a long time was behind overseas, like Europe. They had their firefighters riding on seats back in the, 19s and the early 20s.
Oh, really? Yeah. Oh, wow. Well, this is all fascinating, Rick, but how did this get you into the direction that you're going? So this is all your background. Mm-hmm. Was it, this series that I've created is all about who do you know, because it's all about connections. Mm-hmm. So did you come across somebody who was a mentor who made you think of the bigger box of taking your company to Impactus or starting it?
Well, as I transitioned in my career, starting out as a volunteer there in New Jersey, enlisted in the Air Force, ultimately became a firefighter there, then as a civilian as well with the Air Force. And I jumped over to the Marine Corps and was firefighting with them until I got moved to another career field because of too many people. Wound up out here in Loveland because my wife was working for the city of Loveland at the time.
Okay.
We weren't married then. I was introduced to her. We had a long distance relationship. And so, I'd been out here maybe a year and I got back in the fire service. So, 37 years total, 30 of those here in Loveland. And,
wow.
When I retired in May 2020 as a battalion chief, which most of that time as a battalion chief was as a shift commander, I did have about approximately 15-month stint as the training chief. So all of these things tie into where I'm at now. Back in, it was about 1981, 82 at the latest, is when I had the opportunity to teach my first class. I was stationed at Lowry Air Force Base in Denver at the time.
Oh, okay.
And so it was a firefighting subject, and I enjoyed it. And I was also taking the crew that was assigned to me, we'd go over to our training area and, we were doing hands-on training. And even then, a couple of the guys said, Davis, you seem to have a talent, for this, you should consider pursuing being an instructor. Well, fast forward, down through the years. And so as we talk about the mentor, there's been a number of mentors, throughout the years, people that have been influential in my life, in particular to the fire service. There was a gentleman right there in Cedarville named Art French, or Frenchie. He kind of took me underneath his wing when I was hanging out at the firehouse, and eventually allowed me to do a number of different things where I learned. And I spent a lot of time listening. I was a really shy kid, very introverted, and so I a lot of time listening. And then there was two guys over in Philadelphia, Bill Proudman and Rich Gardner. They were both on the fire department, and I had met them. And Rich in particular would spend, you know, sometimes up to 2 hours on the telephone with me talking about the job and mentoring me. If we, you know, and then I had the mentors in the military as well. But let's jump up to Loveland, one of the men that, you know, had a big impact on my career and, you know, helping me along. His name was Dick Miner. And Dick was a fire chief here in Loveland. And he's retired. He spent, I think, like 40 some years in the fire service. And I had some pretty incredible opportunities under Dick, including one of the first big ones was I ran the hazardous materials team here.
Oh, okay.
At Loveland Fire. And so that opened up even more doors for teaching. And then from the leadership realm, you know, this leadership training, you know, and growth development was interspersed throughout all of this. Plus, I had the opportunity to co-teach with another gentleman at our church here in Loveland. And many of the times, well, the pastor was my father-in-law. And so he gave us a lot of latitude. Yeah, he might say, hey, I want you guys to teach out of like the book of Proverbs. But beyond that, you know, we had a lot of latitude. And so that's when I started incorporating leadership lessons, you know, coupling it with the examples from the Bible. And then that just continued, you know, to grow over the years. You know, Chief Miner kept encouraging me. He encouraged me to complete my degree, you know, which I did.
Okay.
Completed my bachelor's in business administration and then ultimately went on to complete a master's in fire service leadership. And I had the opportunity to attend a four-year program at the National Fire Academy, the Executive Fire Officer Program. And there was a lot of leadership that was involved in those 4 years. So it's very difficult for me to, other than Dick, to really come back and say specifically, oh, it is this one person, because so many people have, you know, have had that. My wife, my daughters, and there were others that were encouraging me along the way. Two things. Hey, Rick, you ought to write a book. And hey, you ought to start your own company. Well, I did. You know, I did write my own book. I got a copy of it, you know, here.
Oh, good. Oh, good.
I hate that. Oops. The furnace.
Yeah, there you go.
There we go. Yes, the furnace of leadership development. Yeah. And so I did that. And there was a lady that we were working with, two ladies, actually, Polly Latofsky of My Work Publishing down in Denver, and then Susie Schaefer, who was working with her as well. And we got tied in with Susie. And so how this book came about is my wife and I were sitting around one Wednesday night. And I'll tell you why I know it was a Wednesday night here in a moment. And we were talking.
Why would you remember those details, Rick?
And we were talking about it. And my wife said, hey, I heard this lady on KCOL being interviewed about self-publishing. And I said, well, what was her name? And so we brainstormed and she came up with a you know, partial name. I searched it and bang, up came Polly's company. And so I had events tab and I looked at it. Hey, the next day she was hosting a self-publishing 101 down in Denver. And that was a Thursday.
Unbelievable.
Yeah. And I could go. And see, that's the reason I knew it was Wednesday and that it was Thursday, because we had monthly chiefs meetings scheduled on Thursdays. And that Thursday, the meeting got canceled. And so that opened up the opportunity. And my wife and I, yes, we went on down to the lunch and learn, met Polly and Susie. It was an egg and eye. And I walked out of there after talking to both, going through the class and then talking to both Polly and Susie. We walked out of there and stood there in the parking lot of there along Leechdale Avenue. And I looked at my wife and I says, well, I guess I'm writing a book. And so that got that process started. And then, maybe about 6 months into it, or maybe a little longer than that, Susie said, you know, Rick, now's the time. You need to start your business now. She said, don't just write a book and let it go at that. She said, nobody knows who you are, you know, outside of your area. Nobody knows. She says, so you need to start a business. And she says, take advantage of using the book as a business card on steroids.
Yeah.
And so the business came about in June of 2019.
Oh, now, okay.
I'm telling you, you know, when, and we were working a 48-hour shift, you know, and so when you're working a 48-hour shift, and for us as the battalion chiefs, now every 48 on, 96 off. Well, that sounds great, you know, but when you're as a battalion chief, that 96-hour off thing rarely happened. Every third rotation of shifts, we had to pull on-call duty. So now there's 96 hours really that's consumed, you know, to the fire department.
Yeah, and that's a full-time business.
And I was still doing teaching. You know, I've had a company here in Larimer County that I've been tied in with since 2001. And so I was still doing teaching, you know, with them, and a few other opportunities would pop up here and there. But trying to build a business, market the business.
Yes.
It's just not happening.
Yeah. You know,
but what happened is I knew that I was going to have to rotate back into the training chief's position. And I wasn't real thrilled about that because that's even more of a time sucker.
You know,
soaks it all up. So my wife and I, we started planning. And then I was told May 4th, you're going to go in. And I told my wife and I said, Nope. So that's when I sat down, I wrote my retirement letter. And so May the 3rd is when I officially, you know, retired from the fire department. Now, associated with the business building, because now here I am, I can start building, working on my business full time. And that Wednesday, immediately following when I left the fire department, I sat in on a webinar hosted by the John Maxwell team. You know, John Maxwell, the leadership author, you know, coach, trainer.
Yes.
And it was
a very powerful person.
Yes. And it was a video on coaching. And when they got done, they said, at the end, they said, you know, if you're interested in learning more about the Maxwell team, send us an email. Well, by Saturday evening, I was a member of the John Maxwell team. Yeah. And so I've become certified as a coach, trainer, and speaker. And, you know, I have a lot of my own content that I have built over the year. I have my own leadership program, you know, that I've put together. But one of the great things is with the Maxwell team, I can teach 100% content, you know, from there, or I can, you know, cherry pick material that John has and incorporate it into my own. But from the business building perspective, the mentors that I have available to me are just absolutely incredible. And, you know, I've learned things about building a business that I don't think I would have learned, you know, otherwise. I would have just, you know, have struggled.
Yeah.
And Jenny, one of those things is networking. Yeah.
It's huge, isn't
that's
it?
That's how we got connected. Yeah. You know,
exactly.
Yeah. Right. And so, you know, you talked about the mentors earlier, and I'll come back. And so I've got mentors within the John Maxwell team, and, you know, and they offer there's throughout a week, Monday through Saturday, there's like 18 different mentorship calls that I can jump onto, you know, and usually there's a little teaching, and then they open up the queue, you know, and you can get in there, and it's very personal, and it amazes me that what the mentors remember. Yeah.
Oh, so, really?
Yeah. Like, I jump on, you know, and, you know, one fellow named Chris Robinson, he does a sales mentorship call, and I'll just get feedback from him, you know, tips on what I can do to, you know, market myself, market the business. And then it might be 3 weeks later that I'll jump back on, you know, for an update, you know, and he remembers, you know, what I was doing.
Oh my goodness.
Yeah, wow. So that quality of that help.
Yeah. Just that's huge.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
That's huge. And how long of a program is that John Maxwell program?
Do you mean the individual content or?
Well, the one that you went to that taught you about coaching.
Oh, okay. Okay. Well, the webinar itself, you know, it ran about 90 minutes, that webinar, you know.
Oh, but so there was just one to teach you to take it to the next level?
No, that was a webinar that was talking about coaching, you know, and I was like, I wound up taking 4 pages of notes. And so, you know, that's what led me into the Maxwell team, the actual training itself, you know, to become certified as the coach. That's a program within the Maxwell team. And that ran approximately 40 hours, you know, in that neighborhood there. And then I also had the opportunity, there's a mentorship call related to the coaching. There's mm-hmm. always ongoing training mm-hmm. related to coaching and leadership and the speaking. Mm-hmm. And I mean, this is continually ongoing. And then one of the great things I like about it is they have a coaching partnership. Like this morning at 6 a.m., you know, I was on the phone with my coaching partner and she's in Chicago. And so it's 90 days. So it's the opportunity to, you know, go back and forth and coach each other to, you know, stay fresh and, you know, put into practice the content that comes, the new content that comes into play, you know, with anything, but in this particular case here, coaching.
Right. Well, that's very important for your business. You know, I'm going to go back to when my husband and I were in the printing business and we were always getting the material to keep us up to date. We were always going to conventions to learn about new equipment. And I think that's just a part of business, mm-hmm. being a business owner, that you have to keep up with times because they're constantly changing, especially in today's world.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. There's changing in other aspects as well. Yeah, because, you know, first time we talked, I told you I learned how to run printing presses in high school. You know, and did that.
Yes, the commonality. Yeah.
And so for, you know, any organization, you know, whether it's, you know, something as large as the military, you know, all the way down to, you know, the mom and pop store, on the corner, there's always technological aspects that are associated with any profession. And, you know, and so you always see, you know, these conferences, like you just mentioned, you know, and trainings that people can go to, but, and this is a big but, the majority of the time, it's always focusing on some type of a technical skill. It's not focusing on the leadership skills.
Oh, and, definitely. Yeah, oh, correct.
And this is where problems start to erupt. Yeah, we have people that they're fantastic. I mean, hey, from a logistical standpoint, they know what needs to be ordered, when to order it, who to order it from, so forth, so on like that. There's people who are fantastic, you know, from an accounting standpoint. You know, there's people that I know how to start a business. And, you know, I hear it on them so many times, start a 4 or 5 businesses. You know, they're really good at that. But where the breakdown comes into play is the people. Yeah,
you do need those people. Mm-hmm. You know, you need that balance.
Yeah. And so, you know, you've got Joe or Betty that are highly skilled and technically competent in their job. And, you know, so the boss will see that and say, wow, those two, you know, they're doing fantastic. We're growing, we're expanding, we're taking on a new project. Let's promote Joe and Betty. Let's put them in charge of 2 different teams. You know, and you each got 10 people on your team. Well, you know, here's where now it starts to go south. Joe and mm-hmm. Betty work very, very well technically, but they've never mm-hmm. received any type of training, you know, mm-hmm. from a leadership perspective or how to communicate with some people can communicate very well, others don't. Stresses come into play now. Joe and Betty aren't used to the extra responsibility of being a supervisor.
You're so right.
and the team gets frustrated, and the team can get to the point of you have some that are open rebellion, some that, well, I don't care. I'm just coming to work, getting a paycheck. You know, Joe and Betty are getting frustrated. You know, the boss is getting frustrated, saying, what in the world happened? You know, calling him in, what's wrong with your attitude?
Exactly.
And this tremendous breakdown and gap and failure to understand that, hey, why don't you invest in Joe and Betty's development as a leader?
Yes.
And your company, your organization is going to grow more. And those people on the team that are frustrated or checked out, you know, very well, it's going to turn around because now Joe and Betty are treating them like human beings.
Yeah.
They're listening to them You know, and hey, when people are happy in the workplace, people are more productive. So that's I've observed this throughout my entire career. I seen it in the military, you know, and I seen it in the fire service. But another but the difference with the military is the military teaches people leadership, you know, from right out the gate in boot camp, they teach leadership. The fire service is back and forth. You know, there are some fire departments, you know, they do a very good job, you know, at preparing their people. There's others, they don't. There's some, they wait until someone expresses an interest in, you know, being promoted to a position of an officer. And then it's like, oh, geez, I guess we ought to give these people some training.
Give them a cram course.
Yeah. You know what? Yeah, you. Yeah, if you take Joe and Betty now and you put them over in the fire department and they're going all the hands-on training and so forth like that, but they're not getting any leadership training along the way. Now Joe and Betty are starting to act as an officer and then they get promoted to an officer's position. They haven't been trained in these skills along the way. And how many bad habits have they picked up? You know, that they carry in. Bad habits that, you know, because people watch these videos, you know, on their phone, YouTube, so forth like that, or they'll watch and they'll see some, their favorite actor who's portraying a leadership position, you know, belittling people, putting them down. And now they think, oh, I guess that's how you do it, you know?
You know what I noticed, though, is that so many times after we get out of college, paying for college, we seem to pull ourselves back and say, oh, why would I want to pay for another course? Mm-hmm. You know, so we devalue ourselves and we don't realize how important it is to keep mm-hmm. up on these and keep learning these things.
That, you know, Jenny, and that is a big challenge that I have confronted since working in the business full time. Yeah. And that's people's reluctance to, you know, want to pay for coaching, pay to go to a mastermind, you know, or, you know, pay for a webinar or a course.
Right.
And people will invest money in what they are interested in. And I have seen people, I'll come back to the fire service, you know, on this one.
Yeah.
And I'll qualify my statement by saying I'm not opposed to what, you know, somebody's doing as their hobby, as long as it's legal, you know, who's going goose hunting, deer elk hunting, fishing, boating, you know, anything like that. But I had a conversation one year with a guy that it ended previous conversations, you know, and he had talked to me, you know, about pursuing, you know, a bachelor's degree. He had his associates and he talked about, you know, his family, providing for the family, you know, what happens, you know, to my family if I get injured on the job and I can't do this anymore. I don't think my associate's degree is going to carry me very far. What should I do, Rick, you know, to pursue the bachelor's degree? Yeah. And this was an ongoing conversation for a couple of years. And it was always ended with him saying, well, I'm not sure if I got the money to do this. Well, the last time I had the conversation with the guy, we were standing in the kitchen of one of the fire stations and same thing. And he ended with, well, I just don't know if I have the money to do this. And I happened to look out the window. And I says, that's your new truck out there, isn't it? He said, well, yeah. And I says, that trailer and that boat out there, that's yours? He said, yeah. And I said, aren't you headed up to Wyoming for a week with a bunch of the guys to go fishing? Yeah. He said, yeah. And I says, you're spending money on that, right? He said, yeah. I said, I'm not opposed to that. I said, but you got a lot of money invested out there in rolling stock. And I said, but yet you're not willing to invest in your personal growth. And I said, there's a disconnect there. That's the last time a guy ever said anything to me about personal growth from that standpoint. From that standpoint.
Did he sign up?
No.
But that's what keeps happening. I've seen it in myself. I know I'm not the only person. I've had people, I would say, oh, I would like some development in this area, whether it's speaking or whether it's how to handle this situation. And I allowed other people saying, oh, you don't, you're good enough. You don't need that sort of stuff. And I go, okay. And then finally, 2 years into it, I finally said, no, this keeps coming up for me. I'm not happy with myself. The heck with it. I'm investing in myself. And it really took a complete change of attitude and approval of myself to accept the fact and let go of my ego and say, no, they don't hear this little George on my shoulder saying, whatever it is, you know, how insecure you feel or not confident. Well, get over it. You know, something is holding you back. Mm-hmm. And usually you have to sit down and figure out what your goals are and what it takes to get to the point that you want to. You know, and I see this, it's not just me. A lot of people put up with this attitude that, no, I can't, I don't have the money.
Yeah, yeah.
Where are those priorities? Mm-hmm. And I think what I've seen is that if people write down what they really want and get clear on their goals, that is when they start to realize that, yes, it's okay to invest in myself and improve because here is the goal that I want. And this is what it's going to take to get me there, along with the confidence, along with the self-growth, along with all these other things that it takes to get there. Just as you're saying, Rick, this is so valuable, all the input that you're giving for people to think of if they want to be a business owner. I agree that a lot of people think they may be, but there is so much that goes into being a business owner that a lot of people don't think of.
Yeah.
And you're pointing so many of these out for our listeners. I really appreciate you sharing so much of this information.
Well, so thank you.
You've got your book, and how long you've been doing this since June of 2019, you said, is when you got started in your business.
Uh-huh.
And the networking. So how are you finding your clientele? Who's your clientele? And have you built your business with employees, or is this just you and your wife that are handling all of this?
I'll start with your last question and then work backwards.
I know, I get so excited. I just throw out all these questions.
Yeah, that's fine. I guess you could say my employee would probably be my dog, Java. Oh. Yeah, because she sticks to me like glue. you know, it's a sole proprietorship, you know, although, you know, my wife definitely is, you know, a partner from the standpoint of providing, you know, encouragement and, you know, ideas and being a sounding board. We've been, last month, you know, we celebrated 34 years, you know.
Oh, marriage. Congratulations.
Thank you. And so, you know, I've been blessed, you know, to have her as a wife. And then also my daughters, my two daughters, they're both married as well. And they get entrepreneurial spirit in them too. But they provide encouragement. And, you know, my youngest, she works for a realtor and here in Loveland, which her boss, Nancy, and I, you know, we've been, you know, brainstorming on what we can do, you know, to work together. And so my older daughter, Rebecca, she's constantly selling my book or pushing my book, you know, and my business, you know. So, you know, I've got that, you know, with them. You know, Rebecca's big on social media. And so she'll take things and, you know, she'll repost it and so forth like that. And yeah, so, you know, coming back to that, you know, from the networking perspective, you know, the niche confronted that right off the bat with the book. And Deb and I, Deb's my wife, we met with Susie early on. I think it was probably about September, October 2017, you know, when already after the class. And we met her halfway between here and Denver. We're sitting in a Chick-fil-A. And my wife and I had been talking about, hey, who am I targeting? And I kept saying, well, the leadership was for everybody. And so Susie shows up and and she said, okay, Rick, who are you writing to? And I said, hey, everybody in here, you know, everybody in here needs leadership. And I saw my wife, she kind of had a grin on her face, and Susie said, no, that doesn't work.
I know, we all start out that way. Well, I can help anybody, you know?
Yeah. Yeah. And
narrowed it down. That's what got you started on narrowing it down. And who is your target market now?
And it was the next day, Jenny, at work. I was visiting, was making station visits out at one of the stations, and there was one of the lieutenants, and he said, I was at the table with him because my habit was, you know, I did station visits, get the crew together, you know, we sit around the table, you know, pass along information. Usually the conversation would go down the path many times of leadership. So I got done talking to guys. One of the lieutenants said, hey, chief, you got a minute? And then, you know, which that's a misnomer. A minute usually means 45 at the minute.
Right, right.
And so we went in the other room, and well, he had some challenges that he was facing, you know, with a younger firefighter, newer firefighter. And this individual that I was speaking to, the lieutenant, you know, he's probably approximately 33 age.
Okay.
You know, in that area right there. So while we're talking back and forth, it's like the light went on. Rick, that's your target audience right there. It's people like this. You know, that, you know, maybe that age range, you know, but, you know, when you're starting to look at people, you know, even now, you know, late teens going into those early 30s, you know, people are, you know, either testing to be promoted, which that's how it happens in the fire department, you have to test, or they're being thrust into it.
Okay.
And so those people that are, you know, wanting to learn about leadership because they're in supervisory positions all the way up to that mid-management, you know, level. You know, that's the group that I like to work with. Specifically, hey, I love working with fire departments. You know, I mean, I spent 37 years of my life, you know, doing that. But then, you know, expanding out, but keeping it, you know, within that same track, as I also enjoy working with industrial emergency response teams. And, you know, because there are, you know, the similarities and so forth. But my primary target audience, you know, would be fire or emergency services. However, I've also, you know, delivered my programs to churches and to, you know, private corporations as well, and other government entities that had no connection whatsoever with fire.
What about Rotary Club?
I'm not a member of the Rotary, but yes, I would, you know, deliver you know, to the Rotary. I have an opportunity in November to address the Sertoma Club up in Fort Collins.
And is that a Rotary Club? I don't recognize that name.
Oh, Sertoma. Yeah, that's another service-oriented club.
Oh, like okay. You
know, Rotary, okay. Sertoma, Lions. Back where I grew up out there in Jersey, there was another one called the Roratan. You know, my Uncle Cliff, he was a part of that. And
yeah,
very influential.
It sounds as though you've got all sorts of connections. And what you find with connections and building relationships and all this networking is it goes from one and then it's a lot of hearsay.
Yeah. And, you know, the great thing, too, about what I'm doing is I don't have brick and mortar, you know. And
exactly.
So, you know, I've delivered across the country virtually. So I've been in person, you know, but I have delivered virtually, you know, as well. You know, and of course, there's a cost savings for an organization. You know, there's downsides to it because you know, trying to, you know, address a group and get feedback, you know, when they're in one room, you know, becomes a challenge. But then from the organizational side, it's like, well, they don't have to pay, you know, travel, you know, and all of that stuff.
So maybe your audience gets bigger. And then the challenge is, how do you deliver it? Do you use Zoom or what program do you go with?
At Loveland Fire Rescue, we had adopted Zoom several years before that because you can't bring everybody together in the fire department and train because now everybody's in one location. You know, and so the other parts of the jurisdiction are not protected. And so, you know, we went to Zoom. And so when I needed to do a shift meeting, we did it on Zoom. When I wanted to deliver a training to the shift and I wanted everybody present one time, present at one time, we didn't via Zoom. There's other times that I would take it out and I would deliver it to, two stations at a time. But, so it's a platform that I was already familiar with.
How nice. And they've expanded like crazy. Mm-hmm. You can have, I think 500 people in a room if you want.
Yeah. Yeah, it is crazy. With networking, I belong to Master Networks. And, through that, I've got the opportunity to visit other chapters around the country. So, for instance, tomorrow morning at 6 a.m., there's a chapter out of White Plains, New York, just north of the city. And I'm on that thing, and there's usually 64 to 70 people,
that's great. On that.
Yeah, and so there's others from my chapter here in Colorado that join in, so from down in Texas, Michigan, so forth like that. Yeah, and we all come together. And so now, this platform here has allowed me the opportunity to network beyond Larimer County in Northern Colorado.
Oh, that's terrific. There are other networking companies around. Mm-hmm. I just connected with Tabletop Networking recently. Yes. Mm-hmm. And that's like speed dating. I don't know if you're familiar with that, but I absolutely love that.
Yeah, I attended the one in Longmont this week.
Oh, you did?
Yeah, okay. I've been going to Tabletop Networking up here in Northern Colorado since last October. And Greg and Diane, they do a fantastic job, and their cadre of volunteers who help out. And they're great. And, I've been going now, like I said, since last October. So developing the relationships with the regulars, the people, that come, every month. And what I have seen since June, I can specifically take it back to June of this year, is the people that are seeing me on a regular basis, they're asking more and more in-depth questions about what I do. And you can see the way, because now they're starting to, I think I might be able to connect you with this person or that person.
Does that mean that you're refining your message? Because I know with Tabletop Networking, you only get 1 minute to say who you are.
And Jenny, for the other networking events that I attend, a minute's like an hour. Because like that one at White Plains, there's so many people on, 20 seconds.
Oh, that's all that you get?
Yeah, 20 Ooh. Seconds. Yeah, our chapter, it's 30 seconds. So for a minute, and hey, growing up in the part of the country I did, you could be a fast talker.
I am slow, but remember, I grew up in farm country.
So, with the Tabletop Networking and 1 minute, that allows me to, go that extra time and throw in statistics. And like that example I gave you earlier about people who are technically competent and then getting, promoted to higher positions, is I've been able to take that and refine that down and make that much more short and succinct. And just watching people's reactions at the table, when I'm saying that, it's like, I've seen that. That right there, that certainly helps. And, I like watching the wheels turn, in people's heads.
Oh, I know. And you can see it. Their eyes start to go. You can read their facial expressions and all that.
Yeah.
And just to tell other people, our listeners, the Tabletop Networking, there are a series in a room of about 15 tables and only mm-hmm. 4 people to one table. You bring tons of business cards. And I love the speed dating, I call it. Because I think that they should have it around the country. It's so fascinating. And so many people you can meet in, mm-hmm. what is it, an hour and a half that they have it?
2 hours.
Oh, is it 2 hours?
Yeah, 2 hours with a short break in between.
Yeah. So all this, Rick, is terrific information. Thank you so much for sharing all the terrific about books and about business, networking, personal growth. All these things have been so valuable to people.
Well, thank you.
Connections, mentoring.
People can order signed copies of my book through my website, but it's it's the Furnace of Leadership Development. But it's also available through Amazon and in an ebook format as well. And so okay. The name of my business is Impactus, Cultivating Today's Leaders. And my website is impactusleadership.com.
And we met on LinkedIn. Mm-hmm. And I didn't even realize how close we were and how many connections that we actually have that are similar.
Yeah. Yeah, that's one of the benefits too about networking. Real quick story, I met a gentleman at Tabletop Networking up here in Northern Colorado a few weeks back. We set up a time for coffee with Ziggy's here in Loveland, and we're talking, and he mentioned my doctor's name. And I said, wait a minute, what was his name? And he told me, and I says, oh, a guy about yay high, and he doesn't have any hair. He said, yeah. And I said, oh, well, he goes to my church. And he says, well, he goes to my church. So we met at a networking event, but we're going to the same church, and neither one of us realized.
Well, thank you so much, Rick, for coming on today. And we'll be connected in future networking.
All right. Well, thank you, Jenny. I appreciate the opportunity very much.